that should help you in understanding the anatomy of the kidney a little bit more. So facilitated transport. Let's look at facilitated transport. Doesn't need as much energy input as active transport, but all of these are on an uphill gradient. They're all on an uphill gradient. They all need energy. So facilitated transport, an uphill gradient. So we have an input of energy, an energy molecule to be able to do this. We need ATP to be able to generate this movement. Facilitated transport, think of this as a helper molecule. So it's facilitating another molecule to get through the gradient. It's got the ticket, but it's got you in tow by the hand, if you're the molecule that wants to get in. So it's basically a two-molecule fit, but you're going together in tandem. Okay? Any questions on facilitated transport? It's a very generalized explanation.
Helper molecule? What is that?
A helper. Helper molecule.
It spelled it wrong. That's what.
Oh, I did. Sorry, I'm dyslexic.
That's okay. So I wanted to know what Hepler.
It's subdued. I apologize for my dyslexia. I do that sometimes. I switch. Yes.
For active transport, so I have to require more energy.
It does require more energy. It requires more energy because in active transport, concentration gradient is even steeper upward with respect, if we're looking at an energy gradient with the horizontal, it requires even more energy. So active transport basically is the molecule, here's the molecule, A for active, carrying the other molecule or nutrient or waste product, piggybacking it upward. It's like a weightlifter carrying weights on back, trying to go up on an uphill gradient. It's got a much higher need for an input of energy to do this. Now, all of these all of this is taking place within the tubules, within the glomerulus. So there's a lot going on. Now, we haven't talked about the charges of the different molecules, because that's very specific too. So when we talk about ions, we have two kinds. We have cations, which carry a positive charge, and we have anions, which carry a negative charge. Cations and anions. And then we have polar molecules. Sorry, I should not ions, because they have no charge. Polar molecules, lipid compatible. So polar molecules would be like a carbon molecule, like a carbon-based molecule. When we talk about, how can I explain? We talked about the lipid bilayer of the cell, right? And how lipid is fat. Lipid means fat, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, polar molecules typically are carbon-based. And they typically don't carry the same charge as anions or cations. They're not water-soluble. And usually they're heavier, because your carbon molecules are comprised of carbon and hydrogen. And depending, being that it's not a carbohydrate, also oxygen and different bonding configurations, either syndiotactic, atactic, or isotactic, which just simply means how the carbon molecule chain is laid out. For instance, a saturated hydrocarbon would be a simple straight chain hydrocarbon. no double bonds, no triple bonds. Whereas a you know, a syndiotactic would be you know, maybe one is one molecule, one attachment is flipped this way or this way. Atactic, they're all, they can be double bonds or single bonds, but it's kind of mixed up. There's no order, particular order. But carbon conformation is going to have a bearing on its ability to be able to pass through certain membranes, which is why that certain molecules are extremely toxic to our renal system, particularly carbon-based liquids. Not that you guys are going to be ingesting specifically carbon-based liquids, but I mean, let's say toluene, tertiary butyl ether, byproducts of gasoline, methyl tertiary butyl ether, butane. These organic solvents are not only neurotoxic, they cross the blood-brain barrier, but they're also nephrotoxic. And your liver can only break down carbon molecules to a certain degree. So there are polar molecules that exist in our body, and polar molecules typically, you know, we do have carbon molecules in our body, and those typically are able to move through any type of lipid layer because they are attracted like in like. Like dissolves like, right? Remember I said that? Yeah.
How about plant-based alkaloids?
Plant-based alkaloids.
Oh, alkaloids.
Yeah.
Well, I'm talking about like vodka or something like that, brandy or something.
Okay. When we talk about the carbon and alcohol, thank you for bringing that up. Ethanol is basically what people drink. It's called ethanol. The there are toxic levels of ethanol, regardless of how the ethanol is made. Like in the South, they make all different kinds of moonshine, and just about everything, from fruit to bananas to apples. It's you know. So no matter where the alcohol comes from, if, as long as it's ethanol, there's a toxicity level that will be reached after a person ingests X amount of alcohol. With alcohol, especially with ethanol, the liver will go through a system of breaking things down. That's what your liver does. It tries to break things down to make it not harmful to you, but depending on what you ingest, sometimes it can be extremely harmful to you. So for instance, carbon tetrachloride, which obviously nobody, you probably even knows what that is, but it's a cleaning agent. Carbon tetrachloride, just like methyl ethyl ketone, but the liver will break down carbon tetrachloride, which is, if you take PVC piping, and this is totally off topic, so I apologize, but if you burn PVC piping or something like that, the fumes are released, it's carbon tetrachloride, and that will, your liver will take that type of and break it down into a highly carcinogenic agent. Like the most carcinogenic agent.
And neuro, is that like breathing?
Yeah. Neuro, lungs, mm-hmm. But it'll also, in sufficient concentrations, it'll go into the liver as well. It'll permeate your organs. With ethanol, the body breaks it down initially into something that's easily secreted through the kidneys. That's its goal. That's the liver's goal. Let's make it so that the body can use a portion of it. If we don't know what it is, we're going to break it down anyway, because the liver, you know, doesn't know what everything is. But it'll break it down, usually using the enzyme cytochrome P450. And then when it breaks it down, it tries to make it into something charged that has either a positive or negative charge. That's what the liver tries to do. And when it's charged, it's easily excreted through the kidneys because charged molecules move easier through the glomerulus that I had previously on the board. If a molecule is charged, it can sometimes reverse the concentration gradient due to the homeostasis of the tubules that is maintained through the influx of sodium and potassium. And when there's that homeostasis of the tubules in perfect harmony, another charged molecule can go in when that charge is just right, negative or positive, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it makes that opening. It creates this concentration gradient. Now, if the liver breaks something, well, liver breaks down ethanol into acetic acid. Acetic acid is not harmful. Acetic acid is like vinegar. And that is very easily transported through the renal tubules. However, just like Tylenol, you take over 4 grams of Tylenol, it can shut your liver down. And when one organ shuts down, guess what happens? It's kind of like a domino effect. Boom, 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 boom. Liver can't work, kidneys can't work, heart can't work. Oh, we just crash. You crash. So everything works together. Everything works. Even though everything work has its own work to do, everything works together. That's the magnificent beauty of our Creator, how we exist. So when you think about it, The liver is very intricate in making sure that things exit our body through our renal system. You mentioned, though, which piqued my interest, about plants, because plant alkaloids are carbon-based. Now, for instance, not isopropyl alcohol, but ethylene glycol. And you know what ethylene glycol is? Do you know what that is? You use it in the wintertime. It's antifreeze. It's just antifreeze.
It's sweet. It's kind of sweet.
I don't know.
Oh,
but I know you shouldn't drink it.
I know.
Ethylene glycol is extremely toxic. And do you know how you can reverse the effects of ethylene glycol? If someone were to drink it, even
water.
By accident.
Throw
no, vodka.
Water. Oh, vodka.
Wow.
Why? Because it's so close in its molecular structure to ethanol that by drinking a really high 80-90 proof alcohol, what it's going to do, it's going to short out the effects of the ethanol, because you see, your liver is going to take ethylene glycol, and its byproduct turns it into formaldehyde. Guess what they use formaldehyde for?
To
preserving
embalm
balm
people.
Bodies. Formaldehyde.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone were to drink that, they would die from formaldehyde poisoning because the liver is going to change it. So by ingesting an alcohol, like at a really high proof, it's going to competitively inhibit the process of the ethylene glycol to transform into formaldehyde in the liver, and break it down into ethanol, which will, the liver will break it into acetic acid. But definitely call poison control if that were to happen. Don't say, oh, I just drank ethylene glycol and now I'm going to drink
right.
A fifth of vodka. No, don't do that. Just call poison control. Too much. Yes, I'm sorry. Shavante. You had a question? Okay. So yes, going back to the original lecture about renal toxicity and different things that can cause our renal system to shut down is directly related to our liver. Absolutely. Absolutely. So we need to know about these, because guess what our renal our dialysis machine does? It kind of does the same thing. But the energy the input of energy comes from the machine. We can just plug it into a wall, can't we? We got the energy from electricity. Our body has to generate energy, right? And most of our energy molecules are generated from the mitochondria, going back to the cell, right? Energy molecule, we said, was ATP. This is an energy molecule. And not to get into too much of biochem, but when molecules want to get through a cell, there's a conformational fit, a lock and key. And sometimes, to fit into the cell, molecules have to change their shape. This is really cool, because there's tertiary, quaternary structures where molecules can actually become convoluted to change their shape to be able to attach to the certain glycoprotein antennae that sit on the surface of our cellular membrane. And while we don't have to get into the chemistry of that, because you are going to be the people that have to assess health issues, I think it's important to know how our kidneys work, right? It's important to know how our kidneys work, because the inventor of the first dialysis machine didn't look like this. And this is an archaic model. This is like R2-D2. No offense to R2-D2. But, because he really hasn't changed much. But the point of it is, they figured out a way to mimic the kidneys and how to clean our blood and put it back. Are you familiar with plasma centers?
Mm-hmm.
Plasma
mm-hmm.
centers?
Mm-hmm.
You know, not a lot of difference, except when the blood comes back, if it's tinged by acetic acid, then it's gonna bind too much calcium, and it's gonna cause clotting disorders in our body. Just FYI, if you decide to give plasma, because they give you a lot of money for plasma, it's like $75 a pop. You should ask me. You can't put a price on plasma. I mean, obviously people need it. Yeah.
You know, I thought just the opposite. Since, you know, I worked at the blood bank, I thought that once they was taking the blood, you know, once they take it to the centrifuge room and stuff, they take out the plasma, they bring you back your blood. You know, I see a lot of clot that stays in the blood, in the bag, but it never goes back to the person. But you say it is.
Well, acetic acid is like a blood thinner.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's kind of like a blood thinner. And it does that by chelating the calcium. So, obviously you don't want your blood to be thinner, but at the same time you don't want any coagulopathy going on either, which
right.
means a type of clotting disorder. So they have to be careful, because we had a whole bunch of people from the plasma centers taking our dialysis class, and it was very interesting, because I don't really know that much about plasmapheresis. But the more I learned, the more it scared me for the people that were going in there. Even though they said they did a thorough workup on them, it was still kind of scary, because if you chelate calcium is an extremely important molecule in cardiovascular health and the health of the heart. The myocardium, the cardiac cells use a lot of calcium, because cardiac muscle tissue is similar to that of brain nervous tissue. It's extremely sensitive. The levels are based on certain calcium concentrations within the cells. So anytime you play with calcium, hypo or hypercalcemia, you have trouble with cardiac function. And we'll get into electrolytes, probably not today, but we'll probably next week we'll get into electrolytes. So. When I give you a quiz next week, which your first quiz is going to be next week, I'm going to tell you what's going to be on the quiz the last few minutes of class today. Okay, so about 8:45, I'm going to go over what you need to know for your quiz. Most of my quizzes for dialysis are going to be on the board. So I'm going to write 10 questions on the board, you're going to take out a sheet of paper, and you're going to answer them. I'm the kind of teacher that likes more information than short answers. If it's a short answer, it better be profound, to show me that you really understand that. Okay? There can be profound short answers that will wow me, but I'm looking for explanations. I'm looking for it. Yes, go ahead. I'm sorry, Shavante.
For example, like something like this. Like, would you want us to spell it out, or would you be able to?
No.
You can't create, like,
may put, well, I will put, I'm going to give you each of these and ask you to explain it to me. That means you're going to have to research this a little bit. Okay, there's some really good scientific websites.
But aren't molecules finite again? Finite again? Aren't molecules like endless? Isn't there a million different types of molecules now?
Pertaining to what? Exactly.
You're telling us to research, so I'm like, okay,
not the molecules. No, no, I don't want you researching the molecules.
Osmosis and
definition of osmosis.
Concentration of gradients.
Diffusion, facilitated transport, and active transport.
Is it all in the handouts?
I don't know if those are in the handouts. Some of the stuff that I lecture on is not in the handouts. So you need to be note-taking for this. You're not going to find everything in handouts. But I wish that were the case. But unfortunately, it's not. Okay, so let's move on. So, help me out now with the kidney. Tell me the most important functioning unit of the kidney. What is it? A what?
A nephron.
A nephron. That's going to be a question. What is the most important functioning unit of the kidney? The nephron. And then I would like you to name some structures within the nephron, which you're going to get from what?
Or the notes,
my biology people, anatomy and physiology people, go nuts. Give me more. I want to push you guys. I want to push you guys to learn, to do better, so that when you get into your jobs, you're going to wow. More importantly, your people will be safe. Your patients will be safe. That's what we're going to, that's our main goal, right?
Mm-hmm.
Our patients are going to be safe. So give me some structure. So how many questions is that so far? Five. Five questions so far. Okay, let us switch gears right now and move toward the patient. Okay, we did a little bit of science, a little bit of biology. Let us move now toward our patient. Because that's what we're here for, to take care of our patient. So all of you here should know vital signs. But like any medical class that deals with helping people get better, learning how to treat people, we need to know the parameters of vital signs and what the major vital signs are that we're going to take. So for instance, we need to know pulse. Right? We need to know
respiration.
Thank you. Respiration. Temperature, good.
Blood pressure,
excellent. And we're going to add one more, which is typically a nursing assessment, O2 saturation. You know when you go to ER and they put that little thing on your finger?
Yeah.
I think, what's this thing on my finger?
Measuring
your O2 saturation, which, coming back around, is based upon the oxygen within your hemoglobin. Cool, huh? Because guess what? Typically really good oxygen saturation, not necessarily can you infer that their hemoglobin levels are good. It's not a direct correlation, but it's not bad. Somebody who's severely anemic, less than 8, maybe a 7 or a 6, may not have that high of oxygen saturation. Or somebody that has lead poisoning. Does it lead in the Flint River, right? Is it lead?
Yeah.
Now that's crazy. That's craziness. Because all the little children and all the people that drank that water, lead competitively binds for the heme binding site within the hemoglobin molecule, kicks out iron, just kicks it right out. So lead will not bind to oxygen. People are going to have low energy, they're going to be anemic. It's going to affect their neurological ability to learn. That's just tragic.
Mm-hmm.
But lead, obviously, is weaker. So pulse O2, I bet their O2 stats are affected too. bet you they're all, if someone were to take vital signs on some of these people that have been drinking lead-laden water and measure their concentrations, it's going to affect their O2 saturation rates. And their hemoglobin is probably dropping. So let's take a look at all of our vital signs here. So pulse. What type of pulse are we going to take when you first intake your dialysis patient? Typically, you'll use a DynaMap. We're going to all use a DynaMap. But if you have to take a pulse, what's a normal pulse that you take? Where is
60 to 100 radio.
Okay, 60 to 100, it's radial. Where's your radial pulse?
Right.
Where the wrist articulates with the
thumb. 2 inches down.
Radial, right here. This is our radial pulse. That's brachial. We're taking a brachial pulse. Which isn't bad. You have to press a little harder. It's a little deeper. But your radial pulse is right here, right?
Right by the thumb.
And we take it for a full minute, don't we?
Right.
So our pulse, we know to be between 60 and 100 beats per minute. Mm-hmm. Now, if the pulse is high, it means it's greater than or equal to 101, and that makes it tachycardia. Tachycardia. These guys are going to run into each other here. If it's low, or less than or equal to 59, we have what?
Bradycardia.
Now, you have been used to taking vital signs and reporting it to the nurse. That's what your jobs have typically entailed. As a dialysis technician, you are going to have to know how to integrate these things because they don't want you to tell them they have a tachy pulse. They want you to be able to put together, well, if their pulse is tachy, what's their respiration? Is it also high? Or rapid, do they have tachypnea? And why is it high? Is it because they're really hypotensive? Because their blood pressure is really low? See, now you're going to have to start putting all of these together and painting a picture of your patient. That's what assessment is. Okay, that's what nurses do. That's what physicians do. We assess the patient. So the days that you used to be able to say, I can just report it, the nurse is going to take care of it, well, that may be not the case now. It may be you are the one that's going to have to intervene with the nurse to bring the patient back to where they have, you know, homeostasis and normal vital signs, okay? Okay, so pulse, high and low. How many pulse points are there? Do you know all your pulse points?
A lot, okay.
Yeah. We can go with that. Subclavicular, let's start from the head. The two pulses that we can feel right here, don't press on them together. Carotid. Carotid. Brachial. Radial. Yeah. Femoral. In your thigh level, in your groin area. Behind the knee, popliteal. And on the arch of the foot, where the arch kind of slopes down, pedal. Pedal pulses, which you guys are going to have to know when you're assessing your dialysis patient. Especially when you do assessments on them and you think maybe there's something not right. You want to feel for those pedal pulses. Check the pulse points. I had a student a few months back, one of my phlebotomy teachers called me. Well, we were all here, and she says, "Oh my God, Nancy, one of our students, she passed out, and I can't wake her up." Okay. I went to her. She was just kind of like this, young girl. I felt her for her radial pulse. I couldn't feel it. So my heart just kind of skipped a beat for a minute.
CPR.
Well, I went and felt her carotid, and it was beating nice and strong. You know, and then her carotid pulse was beating nice and strong. So I just kind of had to massage her shoulders, talk to her a little bit, because you have to talk to people when they pass out. You can't just let them sit there in silence. Yeah, Shavante.
I have a quick question. Like, for something like that happened, for example, would you check here first, or would you automatically?
No, check the radial. Uh-huh. Check the radial first. You don't I wouldn't automatically jump to the carotid. But in this case, it was kind of unnerving. I really couldn't feel it. I couldn't feel the radial, but she was okay. We got her some orange juice, and she was okay.
So,
she wasn't diabetic. She was having her blood drawn. She had a vasovagal effect. She just kind of passed out in the chair, but she was out a little bit too long. So there might have been some underlying, you know,
something
disease processes. Mm-hmm. She was very young, so she might have been a pre-diabetic. That's mm-hmm. possible, too. Her blood sugar may have been low, but once she came back, it didn't take her long to get her bearings. So let's take a look at respiration, okay? I'm going to erase, I'm going to take respiration, I'm going to bring it down here, so to save room on the board. So let's look at respiration. Okay, respiration. What is respiration? How do you count a respiration? You're doing this.
Rise
Karen.
And fall.
What do you call it?
One inhalation plus one exhalation equals
one
respiration. Yes.
Okay.
So the rise and fall of the chest is one respiration. Now, normal respiration, typically 10 to 23, literature may say 12 to 24, it just varies. Greater than or equal to 24, we get into tachypnea. Less than or equal to 9, bradypnea. Now typically, you may have a vital sign above normal or below normal, but it may be normal for the activity that you're performing. So if we're exercising, is it normal to have tachycardia, tachypnea? Sure, we're exercising. Our heart rates are going to go up. We're going to breathe a little faster. If we're sleeping, is it normal to have bradycardia? Bradypnea?
Yes.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. What we need to start thinking about is when the vital signs look abnormal in normal situations, okay? Which make them abnormal. For instance, you're sleeping and your heart rate's 150 and your respiration rate's 28. Abnormal, right? Mm-hmm. At rest, heart rate 150, we have something wrong. Something's wrong. So we have to start putting things together. And little by little, I'm going to help you with these puzzle pieces. So let's take a look at temperature. T-E-M-P. Now, I'm going to show you a mathematical formula to go from Celsius to Fahrenheit and back again. Nobody uses that anymore. Everybody uses Google. It's okay, this is Celsius, what's, you know, I just need to go into Fahrenheit. So you probably will never use it. Mm. And that's okay. But temperature usually is, what, about, 97.6 mm-hmm. to 99.8. You're thinking, wait, 99, yeah. We can't even treat for a fever in a hospital until it gets over 100. I can't even give them Tylenol for 99. I know an infection's happening, but I can't give them anything until the physician says, well, once it's over 100, go ahead and treat with Tylenol, even though I know it would make them feel better. Yeah, Valerie.
Some physicians are now saying children can go to school if the temp is 101 and under.
Okay.
They can.
I don't understand. What do you mean? They can do what?
Like they're not, or like not to treat.
That's ridiculous. 101 is high.
Especially at my school, once they hit 100, we have to send them home.
Yeah, no, 101's high. That's way too high.
A temperature at all.
Period. Yeah, I would agree with that.
Right. That's what I thought, but my daughter's physician's like, no, send them to school still.
Well, I mean, I think it all depends on how the child is behaving, too. I mean, because I've walked around with 101 fever, and trust me, I'm not feeling it. Don't want to be at work. I really don't. Pretty hard to concentrate, right? So this is Fahrenheit, everybody. A high temp, anything greater than or equal to, say, 99.9. A low temp, maybe less than 97.5. Now let's take a look at temperature. If somebody has a fever, we say they are febrile. Okay? A fever means that they're febrile. So here, they have a fever, they're febrile. no fever. A in Latin means without, so no fever is afebrile. I really don't know if there's a particular word to given to a low temperature other than a cause that I could think of would be hypothermia, in which the temperature would drop. Or someone in a cryogenic state for a myocardial infarction, where we put them in a semi-induced coma and lower their body temperature so their heart tissue can heal, which is a pretty phenomenal treatment. But think about it for a second. When do you think somebody's temperature would go up, maybe in a normal situation?
Exercise.
Okay, exercise can raise their temperature, body heat. Okay, so now we're talking about heat exhaustion, okay? Hypothermia versus hyperthermia. Yes, I'm sorry.
Here they're not feeling that their body's going to something.
Okay. Say again.
If you're sick or you have something wrong, it's threatening.
Okay, so neuralgia, body ache, is usually, together with fever. Fever and body ache, yeah. That's very possible. Very possible. With someone who is extremely cold, you would expect their internal temperature to what?
Drop,
right? That's why they say you fall asleep if you're out in the cold. You know, your temperature drops, your blood coagulates, and you just kind of pass out. Hyperthermia would be working out in the desert or working out in Michigan in the middle of summer on the roads, on the blacktop. People can die of heat exhaustion. So yeah, temperature is important, but it's important that you know the difference between febrile and afebrile. So the nurse or the physician asks you, does our patient have a fever? You say no, they're afebrile, no fever. So we need to take temperatures, because when they're on the dialysis machine, sometimes their temperatures can change, especially if you don't warm the dialysate. Here we go. More talk of what you're here for. The dialysate. If that is not at a sufficient or normalized body temperature, it's like having ice running through your veins. Cold. Conversely, if you don't flush the cartridge with your flush and rinse in a dialysis machine, and you just send that brand new cartridge in and you start cleaning the patient's blood, a lot of the residual fluid from the cartridge can get into the patient's bloodstream and cause toxicity. It can cause them to have very nasty side effects. You don't want that to happen. So there's a protocol that we follow. Hopefully everyone has a new cartridge when they go for dialysis, and some of you are thinking, oh my God, do they not use a new cartridge? Did they use a cartridge on somebody else? No, of course not. But sometimes they can reuse a cartridge on your cartridge. But that doesn't mean that you don't still do a rinse and flush. Personally, I prefer a new cartridge every time. Rinse it, flush it, make it new. Temperature. Okay, I'm going to erase this since you've got these down. This is a little bit of review. And we're going to look at blood pressure. Okay, let's look at blood pressure. Blood pressure. So, normal, high, low. So blood pressure has a wide range of normals. You can go all the way from 100 over 60 to being normal to 138 over 89 being normal. But obviously we know this is on the cusp of borderline hypertension, and this is obviously on the cusp of borderline hypotension, right? So if we're greater than or equal to 139 interesting, because while they say body mass index, you know, like if you're getting over the 30s, body mass index, they're looking at obesity, and between like 25 and 30, they're saying obese or overweight. And that's relative to the individual.
Okay.
I can't really put a lot of stock in BMI, except when we're talking about infants and children.
Because I feel like BMI, every time they put me on it, it ain't right.
Yeah, I mean, what's right for you is right for you.
Yeah.
That's what, I mean, you can't really put a lot of stock in BMI.
We use BMI on our pregnant patients, and obviously that's not accurate because they're pregnant. There's
yeah.
no way to calculate their BMI accurately since they're pregnant.
Personally, where I feel, BMI is probably of the most value is when we're looking at people that are at risk. Like your elderly, that are immobile, that maybe get meals on wheels, or they're living at home by themselves, or children that are, you know, either way overweight or way underweight, then you have to worry about, you know, whether or not they're being cared for, if they're wasting. But I think all in all, if you're comfortable in your own skin, don't worry about what literature says. I've seen people that have been in the obese range, they're tall, they're big, and their blood pressure's just fine. It always falls within the normal range. So, and you're right, Robert, sometimes the 138 or 139 can be perfectly normal. High 80s, usually when we have high blood pressure in the absence of anything else, it's considered primary hypertension. Primary hypertension just means that, hey, you got high blood pressure. More than likely, it's familial. Who had it? Grandma, grandpa, somebody in your family had it. Now, with African American people, I cannot stress this high enough, check your blood pressure. Take care of yourself. Hispanic people as well. Hispanic people and African American people have a higher percentage rate of developing hypertension, which can lead to renal failure.
You know why, right?
Here's the thing too, and we're going to talk about this down the road, not today. You need to be culturally sensitive to diet, because everyone in your own right, when you graduate from this course, is going to be a semi-dietitian. You really will. You know why? Because one of the assignments that I give you is a renal diet for breakfast, lunch, dinner, and snack. All the sodium in the entire day can only be 150 milligrams. I think, you know, that's nothing. Ha! I'm challenging you with that. You can start thinking about that right now when you look at everything, that how much sodium is in everything.
When I was in the hospital, they wouldn't give me no milk. I was real hot about that.
Yeah, because milk's got sodium in it.
Yeah.
Did they let you drink almond milk or no?
Nah, they didn't give me nothing.
Nothing. Yeah, they were watching your sodium.
I
bet you did.
Yeah.
I'm a huge milk drinker too.
Yeah.
Milk is great. Yeah.
Is sodium bad for high blood pressure?
Very much so. Where sodium goes, water follows. The more sodium you eat, the more water you retain. The more water you retain, the higher the pressure on the nephrons in your kidneys.
Okay. I'm asking because when I was diagnosed with high blood pressure,
mm-hmm.
I decided to cut down the sodium completely.
Yeah, what happened? You've learned how to balance.
Uh-huh.
Can you tell when your blood pressure's high?
Yes.
What are the signs and symptoms?
Headaches.
Okay.
Sometimes I feel dizzy.
Okay.
Sometimes I don't feel well.
Okay. So Agnes shared with us some of her signs and symptoms of hypertension. Hypertension, fortunately, you have those signs. Some people have hypertension and they don't have those signs, so they can't tell that their blood pressure is way up here. Sometimes with hypertension, depending on how high your blood pressure is, sometimes your ears can get red. You can feel anxious, like you feel nervous. You feel kind of pressure on your chest. Some people will, their eyes will become bloodshot because the tiny capillaries in the sclera of the eye become gorged with blood from the high blood pressure. They'll get headaches, headaches here, headaches in the back of their neck. There's all different signs if you're sensitive to them. Now, when we look at blood pressure, this is going to be one of your major, you're going to put everything together, obviously. We're going to paint a picture of our patient. When a patient is on dialysis and we are removing fluid from them, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we remove fluid too fast, too much, what do you think is going to happen to their blood pressure?
It's
going to
drop.
Hypotension.
Boom! It's going to drop. Right? They're going to become hypotensive. Conversely, if we're not removing it at a fast enough rate, and their blood pressure is staying up there, then their blood pressure can actually go up. They can become, and we can have hypertensive states. The extreme of either of these can be life-threatening. When we start putting this all together with the other vital signs, you're going to start seeing a picture emerge. What we have is a patient whose kidneys don't ever work, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when they come to dialysis to have the dialysis procedure, we're going to help them. We're going to help clean their blood, right? So let's say it's been 2 days since they've been to dialysis. Day three, they come in. Are they going to weigh more than when they went for dialysis last time?
Yes, they will weigh more.
They will weigh more. Why?
Because also their drinking is not going anymore.
Right. They're drinking fluid. Obviously, they're on fluid restriction, as most of our renal patients are. But they've built up fluid over the last 72 hours because it's got nowhere to go. Right?
Yes.
Guess what we call that? Wet weight. That's called a wet weight. What do you think the dry weight is based off of?
Right after the season on.
Yeah, Robert, exactly. So the dry weight, it should be their normal weight, which they should weigh after the procedure. So wet weight is before dialysis. And dry weight is what the patient weighs, let's go ahead, after dialysis. Since most of you know these abbreviations. P with a line over it is what? After. P with a line over it, after. So dry weight versus wet weight. Now, hang on a minute. Dry weight should reflect their normal weight, right? But if that dialysis patient goes home and doesn't feel like eating for 72 hours, let's say they have vomiting and they have diarrhea, they just haven't felt well, can they lose weight?
Yeah.
Dehydrated.
So if you look on their chart, you're looking at their chart, and you look at what their dry weight was, let's say on Monday, say they come back on Wednesday, and you base the dialysis, how much to remove, off their previous dry weight, it wouldn't be accurate now, would it?
Mm-hmm.
Which means that the patient may have what during dialysis? A hypotensive reaction or hypertensive reaction? Hypo. Because they actually weigh less than their previous dry weight.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're using their previous dry weight and we're going to take off the usual, because most people don't fluctuate that much depending on how much weight they gain. You have to keep an eye out for that. If they gain way too much weight between sessions and it's not normal, it's like a point off their chart, red flag. Something else is going on. So there's lots of things that we're going to have to take into consideration when we're assessing our dialysis patient. Okay, so we understand wet weight and dry weight? Yes, everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Typically, every wet person's wet weight is going to vary. that some people don't adhere to their renal diet and the restriction of fluids. This is where we get into diet augmentation. It's like, look, they're diabetic. They're going to tell you, I'm diabetic, so I can't eat sugar. I can't eat what I want. I have to watch commercials on Olive Garden. I have to sit there, and then I want to drink, but I can't drink what I want because I'm limited. And some of them will say, you know, the hell with this. I'm going to go to Olive Garden, and then I'm going to go get a beer. Because I want to. The dialysis patient is kind of hit with a double whammy because they've got numerous comorbidities. We talked about that. They can have diabetes, congestive heart failure. They may have, peripheral venous disease, peripheral arterial disease. They may have numerous things going on. And so they're subjected to the strict regime. How long can you be restricted to such a regime and not just kind of throw your hands up in the air and say, you know what? Am I really living? Mm-hmm. Think about it. Just think about it. It's easy for us to say, oh, I got a job as a dialysis technician. Oh, wow, I'm going to make $17 an hour. Oh, wow, this is great. You know why you're there? You're there for them. Mm-hmm. That's why you're there. You're there to make their lives better. And if they're having a bad day, you're going to have to know about diet. Say, let's talk about this. I get it. I get that you're frustrated. I understand that. Maybe we can sit and figure out what will make your life a little bit brighter, a little bit better. This is why you guys are going to come up with diets. And then when you come up with all these great diets, I'm going to make a portfolio of them, and you're all going to have one. So when you go to your job, you're going to have something to refer to. And I'm going to give you some great websites, too, by the way, to research diets, okay? And when we talk about diets, we have to be what? Culturally sensitive. For instance, the Hispanic people, you know, when they talk about eating frijoles, beans are their source of protein. You know, the Arabic culture, lentils and rice is called the poor man's meat. It's called mujadara. You're going to have to work with them because no one's going to give up their frijoles. No one's going to give up their tortillas and, their cheeses. So we have to think about how do we help them with their diet to eat healthier. Mm-hmm. Obviously, cutting back on salt is one thing. Fats. A lot of Hispanics, the real frijoles are cooked in pork. And they're mashed cold in lard. And they have this phenomenal taste. You know the difference between frijoles and lard and frijoles and vegetable oil.
Well, I'm sure it's probably good.
You know, and so they cook in a lot of oils. They deep, sometimes in families, because lard is cheaper, they'll deep fry their tortillas. Chorizo sausage. Corn tortillas, flour tortillas. Now, don't get me wrong, there's a lot of very healthy foods in the Hispanic diet. A lot of fresh vegetables, fresh, cilantro and tomatoes, etc. But we have to be careful because some of the hot peppers can really raise your blood pressure. Did you know that? The hot peppers can raise your blood pressure? And let me tell you, there's some really hot peppers.
Ghost peppers.
I think who's got it beat though is the Thai people.
Yes.
Okay. They when you ask for something hot over here, down the street at Bangkok 96, do you know they have people that sit there to watch the patrons to call 911?
Oh, really? Truly?
Yeah. They have an ambulance pull up.
Oh yeah.
You know, I'll try that. Yeah. Give me that salad. Make it hot.
Shoot them with your
hand. No.
It's so hot.
Yeah, they sit there. They're sitting there. These guys are sitting there just like this, watching to see who's
so
going to pass out.
Wow.
It's like, oh my God, I can't breathe.
Wow, it's spicy. It's spicy.
So my point is, when we talk to these people, don't come to them with your diet, what you like. but that fits within their renal guidelines. Okay? Cultural sensitivity. My African American relatives here, what do you like?
Anything fried for me.
Okay, fried.
Chicken, oxtails.
So, oxtails. What do you think is the most unhealthy food that you like?
Pork.
Oh, how do you cook it?
Fry it.
Organ food?
Greasy.
Okay.
Greasy organ food.
All right, greasy food. Who doesn't like greasy food? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Greasy food is great. But is greasy food good for your kidneys?
No.
Or your body? Lipids clog your arteries, right? Lipids clog your arteries?
Right.
So we all have to kind of take a seat back, examine our own diets, and we're going to have to start examining culture diets. So next week, I'm not giving you the diet assignment yet, but what I would like you to do next week, I'd like all of you to choose a culture different than your own and explore the different foods that they eat. So when you come back next week, you're going to tell me what culture. French, African, Hispanic, Italian, pick one. Okay, pick a culture. American. American is just like the worst in the world. Just look at all the fast food restaurants. So we're gonna close up the day right now. I'm gonna go over your assignments. I wanna thank you all for coming. It was very nice to meet all of you. Yes, Mia.
Next week we didn't do the total set. Are we gonna do that?
I'm gonna the what?
O2.
O2 sets, yeah, real quick on O2 sets, there's only normal and low. Normal O2 set is 95 to 100, thank you, Mia.
Mm-hmm.
And low is anything less than 95. And we're going to get into O2 sets next week. Okay, so have fun with your cultural diet. 5 questions on the quiz next week. Five questions.
4 things and then that 1 question about the
what was the fifth?
And I'll give you 2 extra credit questions.
Wait,
I 4 questions on what?
Osmosis.
Transports. Okay. I'm going to give you 2 extra credit questions on wet weight and dry weight. Describe it. The 5th question was what? What was the 5th question?
What was
most important function of the kidney?
The nephron. What is it, guys?
Nephron.
Great. Have
okay.
A great night. I'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you, Dave. If we're not
having a fight,
so lead will not bind to oxygen. Those people are going to have low energy. They're going to be anemic. It's going to affect their neurological ability to learn. That's just tragic.
Mm-hmm.
But lead, obviously, is so pulse O2. I bet their O2 sats are affected. I'll bet you they're all. If someone were to take vital signs on some of these people that have been drinking lead-laden water, and measure their concentrations, it's going to affect their O2 saturation rates. And their hemoglobin is probably dropping. So let's take a look at all of our all of our vital signs here. So. Pulse. What type of pulse are we going to take when you first intake your dialysis patient? Typically, you'll use a DynaMap. We're going to all use a DynaMap. But if you have to take a pulse, what's the normal pulse that you take? Where is it?
60 to 100 radial.
Okay, 60 to 100, it's radial. Where's your radial pulse?
Right.
Where the wrist articulates with the
2 inches down.
Radial, right here. This is our radial pulse. That's brachial. We're taking a brachial. Which isn't bad. You have to press a little harder. It's a little deeper. But your radial pulse is right here, right?
Right by the thumb.
And we take it for a full minute, don't we?
Right.
Yeah. So our pulse we know to be between 60 and 100 beats per minute.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the pulse is high, it means it's greater than or equal to 101, and that makes it tachycardia. Tachycardia. These guys are going to run into each other here. If it's low, or less than or equal to 59, we have what?
Bradycardia.
Now, you have been used to taking vital signs and reporting it to the nurse. That's what your jobs have typically entailed As a dialysis technician, you are going to have to know how to integrate these things. Because they don't want you to tell them they have a tachy pulse. They want you to be able to put together, well, if their pulse is tachy, what's their respiration? Is it also high or rapid? Do they have tachypnea? And why is it high? Is it because they're really hypotensive? Because their blood pressure is really low? See, now you're going to have to start putting all of these together and painting a picture of your patient. That's what assessment is. Okay, that's what nurses do. That's what physicians do. We assess the patients. So the days that you used to be able to say, I can just report it, the nurse is going to take care of it. Well, that may be not the case now. It may be you are the one that's going to have to intervene with the nurse to bring the patient back to where they have, you know, homeostasis and normal vital signs, okay? Okay, so pulse, high and low. How many pulse points are there? Do you know all your pulse points?
A lot.
Okay, a lot? Okay, yeah, we can go with that. Subclavicular, let's start from the head. The two pulses that we can feel right here, don't press on them together. Carotid. Yeah, carotid. Brachial. Radial. Yeah. Femoral. In your thigh level, in your groin area. Behind the knee, popliteal. And on the arch of the foot, where the arch kind of slopes down, pedal. Pedal pulses, which you guys are going to have to know when you're assessing your dialysis patient. Especially when you do assessments on them and you think maybe there's something not right. You want to feel for those pedal pulses. Check the pulse points. I had a student a few months back, one of my phlebotomy teachers called me. Well, we were all here, and she says, oh my God, Nancy, one of our students, she passed out, and I can't wake her up. Okay. I went to her, she was just kind of like this, young girl. I felt her for her radial pulse, and I couldn't feel it. So my heart just kind of skipped a beat for a minute.
CPR.
Well, I went and felt her carotid, and it was beating nice and strong. You know, and then her carotid pulse was beating nice and strong. So I just kind of had to massage her shoulders, talk to her a little bit, because you have to talk to people when they pass out. You can't just let them sit there in silence. Yeah, Shabbat.
I have a quick question. Like, for something like that happened, for example, would you check here first, or would you automatically?
No, check the radial first. Check the radial first. You don't I wouldn't automatically jump to the carotid. But in this case, it was kind of unnerving. I really couldn't feel it. I couldn't feel the radial, but she was okay. We got her some orange juice, and she was okay.
So she
diabetic? No. She wasn't diabetic. She was having her blood drawn. She had a vasovagal effect. She just kind of passed out in the chair, but she was out a little bit too long. So there might have been some underlying, you know,
something
disease processes. Mm-hmm. She was very young, so she might have been a pre-diabetic. That's mm-hmm. possible. Her blood sugar may have been a little low, but once she came back, it didn't take her long to get her bearings. So let's take a look at respiration, okay? I'm going to take respiration, I'm going to bring it down here, so to save room on the board. So let's look at respiration. Okay, respiration. What is respiration? How do you count a respiration? You're doing this, Caroline.
What's it called?
One inhalation plus one exhalation equals
one
respiration. Yes.
Okay.
So the rise and fall of the chest is one respiration. Now, normal respiration, typically 10 to 23, literature may say 12 to 24, it just varies. Greater than or equal to 24, we get into tachypnea. Less than or equal to 9, bradypnea. Now typically, you may have a vital sign above normal. below normal, but it may be normal for the activity that you're performing. So if we're exercising, is it normal to have tachycardia? Tachypnea? Sure, we're exercising. Our heart rates are going to go up. We're going to breathe a little faster. If we're sleeping, is it normal to have bradycardia?
Yes.
Bradypnea?
Yes.
Absolutely. What we need to start thinking about is when the vital signs look abnormal in normal situations, okay? Which make them abnormal. For instance, you're sleeping. Your heart rate's 150 and your respiration rate's 28. Abnormal, right? At rest, heart rate 150, we have something wrong. Something's wrong. So we have to start putting things together. And little by little, I'm going to help you with these puzzle pieces. So let's take a look at temperature. TEMP. Now, I'm going to show you mathematical formula to go from Celsius to Fahrenheit and back again. Nobody uses that anymore. Everybody uses Google, or they use Google. It's okay, this is Celsius, what's, you know, I just need to go into Fahrenheit. So you probably will never use it. And that's okay. But temperature usually is, what, about, 97.6 to 99.8, you're thinking, wait, 99, yeah. We can't even treat for a fever in a hospital until it gets over 100. I can't even give them Tylenol for 99. I know an infection's happening, but I can't give them anything until the physician says, well, once it's over 100, go ahead and treat with Tylenol. Even though I know it would make them feel better. Yeah, Valerie.
Some physicians are now saying children can go to school if the temp is 101 and
I don't understand. What do you mean? They can do what?
Like they're not, or like not to treat and to still send kids to school if their temp is like 101 or more.
That's ridiculous. 101 is high.
Especially at my school, once they hit 100, we have to send them home.
Yeah, no, 101's high. That's way too high.
A temperature at all.
Period. Yeah, I would agree with that.
Right. That's what I thought, but my daughter's physician's like, no, send them to school still.
Well, I mean, I think it all depends on how the child is behaving, too. I mean, because I've walked around with 101 fever, and trust me, I'm not feeling it. Don't want to be at work. I really don't. It's pretty hard to concentrate, right? So this is Fahrenheit, everybody. A high temp, anything greater than or equal to, say, 99.9. A low temp, maybe less than 97.5. Now let's take a look at temperature. If somebody has a fever, we say they are febrile. Okay? A fever means that they're febrile. So here, they have a fever, they're febrile. No fever, A in Latin means without. So no fever is afebrile. I really don't know if there's a particular word given to a low temperature, other than a cause that I could think of would be hypothermia, in which the temperature would drop. Or someone in a cryogenic state for a myocardial infarction, where we put them in a semi-induced coma and lower their body temperature so their heart and tissue can heal, which is a pretty phenomenal treatment. But think about it for a second. When do you think somebody's temperature would go up, maybe in a normal situation?
Exercise.
Okay, exercise can raise our temperature, body heat. Okay. Okay, so now we're talking about heat exhaustion. Okay? Hypothermia versus hyperthermia. Yes, I'm sorry.
You're not feeling your body's going to something.
Okay.
Well,
say again?
If you're sick or
okay, so neuralgia, body ache, is usually together with fever and body ache. Yeah, that's very possible. With someone who is extremely cold, you would expect their internal temperature to what? out in the cold. You know, your temperature drops, your blood coagulates, and you just kind of pass out. Hyperthermia would be working out in the desert or working out in Michigan in the middle of summer on the roads, on the blacktop. People can die of heat exhaustion. So yeah, temperature is important, but it's important that you know the difference between febrile and afebrile. So the nurse or the physician asks you, does our patient have a fever? You say no, they're afebrile, no fever. So we need to take temperatures, because when they're on the dialysis machine, sometimes their temperatures can change, especially if you don't warm the dialysate. Dialysate. Here we go. More talk of what you're here for. The dialysate. If that is not at a sufficient or normalized body temperature, it's like having ice running through your veins. You're cold. Conversely, if you don't flush the cartridge with your flush and rinse in a dialysis machine, and you just send that brand new cartridge in and you start cleaning the patient's blood, a lot of the residual fluid from the cartridge can get into the patient's bloodstream and cause toxicity. It can cause them to have very nasty side effects. You don't want that to happen. So there's a protocol that we follow. Hopefully everyone has a new cartridge when they go for dialysis, and some of you are thinking, oh my God, do they not use a new cartridge? Did they use a cartridge on somebody else? No, of course not. But sometimes they can reuse a cartridge on your cartridge. But that doesn't mean that you don't still do a rinse and flush. Personally, I prefer a new cartridge every time. Rinse it, flush it, make it new. Temperature, okay. I'm going to erase this since you've got these down. This is a little bit of review. And we're going to look at blood pressure. Okay, let's look at blood pressure. Blood pressure. So, normal, high, low. So blood pressure has a wide range of normals. It's got, you can go all the way from 100 over 60 to being normal to 138 over 89 being normal. But obviously we know this is on the cusp of borderline hypertension. And this is obviously on the cusp of borderline hypotension, right? So if we're greater than or equal to 139 over 90, it's hypertension. If we're less than or equal to 99 over 59, it's what? Hypotension. Now, let's talk about blood pressure for a little bit here, because this is, yes, Robert.
Will your body mass index have anything to do with hypertension, or, heavy or taller you are, do they got anything to do with it? Like maybe a big, tall person, and their BMI is, pretty normal. Got like maybe 139 over 90, would that be considered high blood pressure for them? It'd be pretty normal, right?
It'd be normal. It's interesting, because while they say body mass index, like if you're getting over the 30s, body mass index, they're looking at obesity, and between like 25 and 30, they're saying obese or overweight. And that's relative to the individual.
Okay.
I can't really put a lot of stock in BMI, except when we're talking about infants and children.
Because I feel like BMI, every time they put me on it, it ain't right.
Yeah, I mean, what's right for you is right for you.
Yeah.
That's what, I mean, you can't really put a lot of stock in BMI.
We use BMI on our pregnant patients, and obviously that's not accurate because they're pregnant. There's no way to calculate their BMI accurately.
Personally, where I feel Yeah, personally, where I feel BMI is probably of the most value is when we're looking at people that are at risk, like your elderly, that are immobile, that maybe get meals on wheels, or they're living at home by themselves, or children that are, you know, either way overweight or way underweight, then you have to worry about, you know, whether or not they're being cared for if they're wasting. But I think all in all, if you're comfortable in your own skin, don't worry about what literature says. You know, because I've seen people that have been in the obese range, they're tall, they're big, and their blood pressure is just fine. It always falls within the normal range. So, and you're right, Robert. Sometimes the 138 or 139 can be perfectly normal. High 80s, usually when we have high blood pressure in the absence of anything else, it's considered primary hypertension. Primary hypertension just means that, hey, you got high blood pressure. More than likely, it's familial. Who had it? Grandma, grandpa, somebody in your family had it. Now, with African American people, I cannot stress this high enough, check your blood pressure. Take care of yourself. Hispanic people as well. Hispanic people and African American people have a higher percentage rate of developing hypertension, which can lead to renal failure.
You know why, right?
Here's the thing too, and we're going to talk about this down the road, not today. You need to be culturally sensitive to diet, because everyone in your own right, when you graduate from this course, can be a semi-dietitian. You really will. You know why? Because one of the assignments that I give you is a renal diet for breakfast, lunch, dinner, and snack. And then you can, all the sodium in the entire day can only be 150 milligrams. I think, you know, that's nothing. Ha! I'm challenging you with that. You can start thinking about that right now when you look at everything, that how much sodium is in everything.
When I was in the hospital, they wouldn't give me no milk. I was real hot about that.
Yeah, because milk's got sodium in it.
Yeah.
Did they let you drink almond milk or no?
Nah, they didn't give me nothing.
Nothing. Yeah, they were watching your sodium.
I didn't like that.
I bet you did. Yeah. I'm a huge milk drinker too.
Yeah.
Milk is great. Yeah.
Is sodium bad for high blood pressure?
Very much so. Where sodium goes, water follows. The more sodium you eat, the more water you retain. The more water you retain, the higher the pressure on the nephrons in your kidneys.
Okay. I'm asking because when I was diagnosed with high blood pressure, I decided to cut out the sodium completely.
Yeah, what happened?
Like, it was feeling dizzy the whole time.
Were you?
Yes.
Okay. Did they have you on blood pressure pills?
Oh, yeah.
Did they?
You were.
Okay, but you've learned how to balance.
Uh-huh.
Can you tell when your blood pressure's high?
Yes.
What are the signs and symptoms?
Headaches.
Okay.
Sometimes I feel dizzy.
Okay.
Sometimes I don't feel well.
Okay, so Agnes shared with us some of her signs and symptoms of hypertension. Hypertension. Fortunately, you have those signs. Some people have hypertension, and they don't have those signs, so they can't tell that their blood pressure is way up here. Sometimes your hypertension, depending on how high your blood pressure is, sometimes your ears can get red. You can feel anxious, like you feel nervous. You feel kind of pressure on your chest. Some people will, their eyes will become bloodshot, because the tiny capillaries in the sclera of the eye become engorged with blood from the high blood pressure. They'll get headaches, headaches here, headaches in the back of their neck. There's all different signs if you're sensitive to them. Now, when we look at blood pressure, this is going to be one of your major, you're going to put everything together, obviously. We're going to paint a picture of our patient. When a patient is on dialysis and we are removing fluid from them, right? If we remove fluid too fast, too much, what do you think is going to happen to their blood pressure?
It's
going to
drop.
Hypotension.
Boom! It's going to drop, right? They're going to become hypotensive. Conversely, if we're not removing it at a fast enough rate, and their blood pressure is staying up there, then their blood pressure can actually go up. They can become, and we can have hypertensive states. The extreme of either of these can be life-threatening.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? When we start putting this all together with the other vital signs, you're going to start seeing a picture emerge. What we have is a patient whose kidneys don't ever work, right? So when they come to dialysis to have the dialysis procedure, we're supposed to clean, we're going to help them, we're going to help clean their blood, right? So let's say it's been 2 days since they've been to dialysis. Day three they come in. Are they going to weigh more than when they went to dialysis last time?
Yes, they will weigh more.
They will weigh more. Why? They're drinking fluid, obviously they're on fluid restriction as most of our renal patients are, but they've built up fluid over the last 72 hours because it's got nowhere to go, right?
Yes.
Guess what we call that? Wet weight. That's called a wet weight. What do you think the dry weight is based off of? Robert, exactly. So the dry weight, it should be their normal weight, which they should weigh after the procedure. So wet weight is before dialysis, and dry weight is what the patient weighs, let's go ahead, after dialysis. Since most of you know these abbreviations. P with a line over it is what? After. P with a line over it, after. So dry weight versus wet weight. Now, hang on a minute. Dry weight should reflect their normal weight, right? But if that dialysis patient goes home, it doesn't feel like eating for 72 hours. Let's say they have vomiting and they have diarrhea. They just haven't felt well. Can they lose weight?
Dehydrated.
So if you look on their chart, you're looking at their chart, and you look at what their dry weight was, let's say on Monday. Let's say they come back on Wednesday, and you base the dialysis, how much to remove, off their previous dry weight, it wouldn't be accurate now, would it? Which means that the patient may have what during dialysis? A hypotensive reaction or hypertensive reaction?
Hypo.
Because they actually weigh less than their previous dry weight. And if we're using their previous dry weight and we're going to take off the usual, because most people don't fluctuate that much depending on how much weight they gain. You have to keep an eye out for that. If they gain way too much weight between sessions and it's not normal, it's like a point off their chart, red flag. Something else is going on. So there's lots of things that we're going to have to take into consideration when we're assessing our dialysis patient. Okay, so we understand wet weight and dry weight? Yes, everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Typically, every wet person's wet weight is going to vary. Some people don't adhere to their renal diet and the restriction of fluids. This is where we get into diet augmentation. It's like, look, they're diabetic. They're going to tell you, I'm diabetic, so I can't eat sugar. I can't eat what I want. I have to watch commercials on Olive Garden. I have to sit there, and then I want to drink, but I can't drink what I want because I'm limited. And some of them will say, you know, the hell with this. I'm going to go to Olive Garden, and then I'm going to go get a beer.
Mm-hmm.
Because I want to. The dialysis patient is kind of hit with a double whammy, because they've got numerous comorbidities. We talked about that. They can have diabetes, congestive heart failure. they may have, you know, peripheral venous disease, peripheral arterial disease. They may have numerous things going on. And so they're subjected to the strict regime. How long can you be restricted to such a regime and not just kind of throw your hands up in the air and say, you know what, am I really living? Think about it. Just think about it. It's easy for us to say, oh, I got a job as a dialysis technician. Oh, wow, I'm going to make, you know, 17 an hour. Oh, wow, this is great. You know why you're there? You're there for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you're there. You're there to make their lives better. And if they're having a bad day, you're going to have to know about diet. Say, let's talk about this. I get it. I get that you're frustrated. I understand that. Maybe we can sit and figure out what will make your life a little bit brighter, a little bit better. This is why you guys are going to come up with diets. And then when you come up with all these great diets, I'm going to make a portfolio of them, and you're all going to have one. So when you go to your job, you have something to refer to. And I'm going to give you some great websites, too, by the way, to research diets, okay? And when we talk about diets, we have to be what? Culturally sensitive. For instance, the Hispanic people, you know, when they talk about eating frijoles, beans are their source of protein. In the Arabic culture, lentils and rice is called the poor man's meat. It's called mujadara. So, you know, you're going to have to work with them, because no one's going to give up their frijoles. No one's going to give up their tortillas and, you know, their cheeses. So we have to think about how do we help them with their diet to eat healthier.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, cutting back on salt is one thing. Fats. A lot of Hispanics, the real frijoles are cooked in pork. And they're mashed cold in lard. And they have this phenomenal taste. You know the difference between frijoles and lard and frijoles and vegetable.
Well, I'm sure it's probably good.
You know, and so they cook in a lot of oils. They deep, sometimes in families, they'll, because lard is cheaper, they'll deep fry their tortillas. Chorizo sausage. You know, corn tortillas, flour tortillas. Now, don't get me wrong, there's a lot of very healthy foods in the Hispanic diet. A lot of fresh vegetables, fresh, you know, cilantro and tomatoes, etc. But we have to be careful, because some of the hot peppers can really raise your blood pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that? The hot peppers can raise your blood pressure?
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you, there's some really hot peppers.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Ghost peppers.
I think who's got it beat, though, is the Thai people.
Yes.
Okay, they when you ask for something hot over here, down the street at Bangkok, 96. Do you know they have people that sit there to watch the patrons to call 911?
Oh, really? Truly?
Yeah. They have an ambulance pull up.
Oh,
yeah. You know, I'll try that. Yeah. Give me that salad.
It's so hot.
And make it hot.
Shoot someone to go.
No.
It's so hot.
Yeah, they sit there. They're sitting there. These guys are sitting there just like this, watching to see who's
so
going to pass out.
Like,
oh my God, I can't breathe.
Wow, it's spicy. It's so spicy.
So my point of it, my point is, when we talk to these people, don't come to them with your diet, what you like. Right? Come to them with a diet that they like, but that fits within their renal guidelines. Okay? Cultural sensitivity. My African American relatives here, what do you like?
Anything fried from
me. Okay, fried.
Chicken, oxtails.
So, oxtails, what do you think is the most unhealthy food that you like?
Pork.
Oh, how do you cook it?
Fry it.
Organ food?
Greasy.
Okay.
Greasy.
Alright, greasy food. Who doesn't like greasy food? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Greasy food is great. But is greasy food good for your kidneys?
No.
Or your body? Lipids clog your arteries, right? Lipids clog your arteries?
Right.
So we all not giving you the diet assignment yet, but what I would like you to do next week, I'd like all of you to choose a culture different than your own and explore the different foods that they eat. So when you come back next week, you're going to tell me what culture. French, African, Hispanic, Italian, pick one. Okay, pick a culture. American. American is just like the worst in the world. Just look at all the fast food restaurants. So we're gonna close up the day right now. I'm gonna go over your assignments. I wanna thank you all for coming. It was very nice to meet all of you. Yes, Mia.
Next week we didn't do the so-and-so set. Are we gonna do that?
I'm gonna the what?
O2.
O2 sets, yeah, real quick on O2 sets. There's only normal and low. Normal O2 set is 95 to 100. Thank you, Mia.
Mm-hmm.
And low is anything less than 95. And we're going to get into O2 sets next week. Okay, so have fun with your cultural diet. 5 questions on the quiz next week.
Okay.
5 questions.
4 things and then that 1 question about the
And I'll give you 2 extra credit questions.
Wait,
4 questions on what?
Osmosis,
transports. Okay. I'm going to give you 2 extra credit questions on wet weight and dry weight. Describe it. The 5th question was what? What was the 5th question?
What was
the most important function of the kidney?
The nephron. What is it, guys?
Nephron.
Great. Have a great night. I'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you, Dave.
If we're not
having 5 and being on the
computer.